Live from the KEMA Podcast studios in Pennsylvania, it's the KEMA Podcast, the emergency management podcast for KEMA members, by KEMA members. I'm your host, Paul Falavolito. Joining me for today's episode, it's Miss Amy Amir.
Hey, Paul, what's going on?
How are you? Happy Saturday.
Happy Saturday. Beautiful weather today here.
Yeah,
on the
crazy,
East
right? Same thing out here in the western part of the state. You know, this no winter thing was kind of bumming me out. I got to be honest with you.
I'm right there with you.
I was hoping for more snow.
Yeah, I need a good snow. We haven't really gotten any out here.
Yeah, I know. But spring will be here soon enough. Isn't daylight savings next week?
Next week or the week after?
Yeah, it's coming up very, very soon.
Yeah.
And then before you know it, Easter will be here.
I can't wait for the Easter Bunny.
Yeah. So, you know, the last episode we did was right when this, you know, coronavirus thing was making the news headlines all over social media. Since then, we're now up to, you know, 78,000 cases. I think when we did this last month, we were only at 4,400. So, you know, we're coming up on the 80,000 benchmark for worldwide cases. A little over 2,300 have died. 21,000 have fully recovered from the coronavirus. And the United States is still holding at right around 35 cases. I know we were at 16 in the last 24 hours, and that number has quickly jumped up to 35. And the CDC put out an article today saying they're expecting the numbers to rise in the United States. And here's a little fact for you. Someone who has been on the show has been involved in managing this in the United States out in his state of California. And that would be our good buddy, Mr. Aaron Bronston.
Aaron.
Yep. So he's not really given me any official feedback or detail other than a few texts, as he was notified that they were getting some of the planefuls of people coming into California. And I, you know, I wished him luck, and, you know, he said when this thing settles down for him out there, he will certainly join us and talk about everything he can talk about.
We really need to do like a whole like KEMA Talks to Aram episode.
We do, because he has a lot of stuff. I know.
Yeah,
he's a great resource and a great friend to us and to KEMA, and we're lucky to have him. But you want to hear a little bit of exciting, crazy news?
Sure. I'm all about crazy news, man.
So I got accepted to the advanced PIO course at EMI in April.
Oh, congratulations.
Thank
I'm
you.
I'm so excited for you.
See, I'm following in your master PIO footsteps, because
I'm so proud.
Once I finish advanced, then I'll have to make the decision, do I want to commit the year of going down to EMI? What is that, 4 weeks or five for master?
It's 3 weeks live on campus.
Oh, okay.
And then there's another, I think you were caught up in the 2 weeks it took me to write my final paper.
Yeah. So that's my news. So what do you got?
Congratulations, I'm so happy.
Thanks.
You're welcome. Let's see. A couple things going on here for in my world. One of the things is that I'm participating with PIMA on the writing of a new county director exercise for Lehigh County.
That's great.
And I'm helping them write the PIO injects for that exercise. And it'll kind of be a new exercise for me because it's an evening exercise in Allentown, in the city of Allentown. So it's a little bit different atmosphere than what I'm used to. So I'm kind of excited for that experience.
Very cool.
The other thing, Paul, is I went to this a couple weeks ago, this National Public Affairs Academy workshop sponsored by Argonne for joint information systems for radiological nuclear incidents. I have to tell you that I've been to so many courses and all kinds of different learning experiences, and by all means, this is probably one of the better courses that I've attended.
Where was that at?
Knoxville, Tennessee.
Wow. Very cool.
Yeah. And I mean, there's such a difference between JICs and you know, joint information systems, joint information centers. And it's just different. The whole class was different. I'm such a FEMA, let me attend a G series course girl, but this was just different. Very eye opening for me.
That's awesome. So, good for you. Yeah. Way to spread your wings and get out there.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. So are you going to tell us about this graphic that I'm looking at on our screen, or is that later?
No, we can talk about that now.
Yeah, please do.
So this was something that I got from that joint information, from that class, the Joint Information Center class. So what it's called, this is what happens in an internet minute. And this is from the 2019, how they calculated everything. So if you look at this, Paul, and I'll make sure that we get this out to everybody, or I'll post it on the KEMA Facebook page. 1 million people log into Facebook every minute.
Wow.
18.1 million texts sent. 4.5 million videos viewed on YouTube. Almost $1 million spent online every minute. 2.1 million Snapchats created.
Holy cow.
I mean, this is just something cool of what happens every 60 seconds on the internet.
That's fascinating.
Yeah.
That's a really neat graphic. I'm glad you shared that with me.
I'll make sure I put it on our Facebook page too.
That's really, really neat. So what's new with KEMA news?
Oh my gosh. Are you ready for this? Are you sitting down? Of course you are.
Yeah.
We opened the call for speakers and the call for vendors this week. On our website, it's posted at KEMAconference.com. I'm looking forward to this year's submissions for courses. We have all kinds of requests, all kinds of conversations I've been having offline for the conference, for the speakers. So I can't wait to see what people actually submit this year. Speaking of the conference, so some of you know that we discussed having a four-day conference. But due to other events that were happening in the Altoona area that weekend, we weren't able to secure hotel rooms at an affordable rate, like a government rate, for us. So we decided to just go with the Sunday, Monday, Tuesday again for this year. But going forward for 21 and 22, we should be able to secure a four-day conference. I am anticipating having those dates for 21 and 22 in the next few weeks, and obviously we'll quickly announce them here. So, that's the big news with the KEMA conference. That's always the big thing that I always like to talk about.
And what are the dates? What are the dates again for this year's KEMA conference? That's October.
I always want to, and I have the Saturday, you know, the adding in of that Saturday date. So bear with me 1 second while I scroll through my phone. It is October 25th, 26th, and 27th at the Blair County Convention Center.
October 25 through 27 at the Blair County Convention Center in Altoona, Pennsylvania for KEMAcon 2020.
Right, the third annual. I never thought.
The third
annual. This is such good stuff.
It is great stuff.
So, speaking of KEMA being places, KEMA, the KEMA conference, maybe the KEMA podcast, will be at the Monroe Fire and Expo, EMS Expo, March 7th and 8th.
The Monroeville.
From KEMA.
The Monroeville Fire and EMS Expo.
Yes.
March 7 and 8, 2020 is just about 2 weeks away. And that's an annual event. KEMA was there last year for the first time in a booth. We're happy to be back here for the second year in a row. And again, this support comes to us from Kelly Simon Event Management, who is the show creator of the Monroeville Fire and EMS Expo. She is a good, good friend to all public safety, and now I'm happy to say emergency management as well, because that was the one area that was missing from that show for many, many, many years. And so last year we were able to drop emergency management into it. We'll be back again this year at the KEMA booth. Come and see Amy. Come and see Bob Gerlach. And, you know, with any luck, we may bring the podcast stuff with us and at least do one or two episodes, but no guarantees, because that's a busy show for me, because I'm heavily involved with Kelly Simon events. And, you know, I can try. I will wear many hats that weekend for the show, but I will try. I will do my best to try to serve KEMA as much as I can. And I also heard we have a new board member.
We do. And she will also, I believe, make an appearance at the expo as well, too. KEMA's new board member is Amy Marie from Butler County. Amy's going to be filling the role of secretary for KEMA as we phase our current management company out.
That's exciting news.
Amy.
Yeah.
Yes.
Very, very exciting news. And again, you know, pay attention to those KEMA emails that you get in your inbox. And again, if you're still teetering on whether or not you want to join KEMA as a member, get onto the website. It is a fantastic organization. We can't say enough about it. We're happy to do this podcast and spread the word of KEMA around the world as much as we can. And, you know, we always look forward to having new members in the association.
Yes, for sure. Thank you.
Great. So let's talk about this week in emergency management news, because there is a ton of stuff that I cannot wait to go over. So PEMA has just recently introduced this great new tool for emergency management. It's called Keystone Mesonet. And what this does is this ties in many, many, many different weather data points into one resource, into one map, so that you don't have to bounce between apps and different websites. It's all there. So if you want to know what the temperature is around the state, you can do that at Keystone Mesonet. If you want to know the temperature of the turnpike, Amy, that data set is available to you on Keystone Mesonet. So it's fantastic. I looked at it very quickly this afternoon. It looks like they have a bunch of other features that are coming soon. But again, fantastic tool for emergency management. If you go to PEMA's website, you can find all the information about it there. You can find the link that'll take you to Keystone Mesonet. It is free. It's a free resource for anybody in the Commonwealth to use. But specifically for emergency management, you want to definitely make sure that you put Keystone Mesonet into your toolbox as a resource, because it's incredibly beneficial. Let's talk about Census 2020, Amy.
Okay.
Because I don't know if you know this or not, but April 1st of this year, it's time for the United States to do their census. And we talk about this for many, many reasons, because the census, you know, it's required by law. You know, all the citizens have to participate in it. For the first time in history, Pennsylvania residents can participate in the census online, which is going to be fantastic and easy. They can also participate by mail or by phone. Again, everyone urged to participate because it matters for two big reasons. Number one, we'll talk gently about politics, right? So, you know, when it's presidential election time, they always say, you know, this state is worth, you know, 22 electoral college votes, and this state's worth 17. In 2016, I believe Pennsylvania was worth 20 electoral college votes in the presidential election. That number of electoral college votes is based on population of the state. So this is why they urge everybody to participate in the census, to get an accurate number of how many residents live in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, because that electoral college number can shift. There was one time back in the early 1900s, Pennsylvania was worth 32 votes. Now it's worth 20. And when they redo this again, you know, it could go up or down or fluctuate by two or three votes either way. So it's very, very important for everyone in Pennsylvania to get the word out and participate in the census. But the other big one is to make sure we get our fair share of federal money in the state. And so that applies to emergency management. That applies to, you know, disaster declarations. I read something on PEMA's website that, you know, although it was an incredibly rainy and wet 2019 with, I think they said 59 inches of rain fell, we were still below the threshold of being able to get money for a lot of the public or for a lot of the federally declared disasters. So again, we want to make sure that we're doing our part with the census So that's why I mentioned that. And then also, it's time again for flood-prone municipalities in Pennsylvania to submit their annual floodplain management activities report by February 29th through PEMA's website. You can go to their website. You can get all the information, get all the documents that you need. But that's coming up, and that's due, and that's in its own little text box on PEMA's website, reminding everybody it's time to do that. And here's some more exciting news, and I'm looking incredibly forward to this. The Governor's Emergency Preparedness Summit is May 18th through 20th at the Kalahari Convention Center and Resort in the Poconos. Now, I've never been to the Poconos. I've never been to that part of Pennsylvania. So this is a great reason for me to go to this summit. I can't wait to see it. I can't wait until PEMA releases all the information on their website about what the course offerings are going to be, who the speakers are going to be. But this is going to be a fantastic opportunity for all of emergency management to get together, under the PEMA banner, under Governor Wolf, for the Governor's Emergency Preparedness Summit. Now, I think the last one was in 2017, right?
Yes, I believe
so. Yeah, and KEMA, I saw in there, KEMA had a lot of stuff. KEMA had an annual meeting, and then it was after that is when you guys decided to do your own conference. Is that pretty? Correct. Is that kind of accurate? So, again, I think it's a good thing, you know, to be able to have in the calendar year 2020, to be able to have two world-class events like this happening in Pennsylvania for emergency management. Brilliant. Great. Great. Can't wait to go and attend. But are you ready for some fun PEMA facts from 2019?
Sure.
Because you know me. I'm like such a numbers junkie, and I love facts, and I love these kinds of reports. So the 2019 PEMA report, 43 counties throughout the Commonwealth with the text to 911 capabilities, with near full deployment expected this year. And we talked about that a bunch of episodes back about it. So that's very cool that number makes it into this report. 43 counties with text to 911 in 2019.
So in all reality, there's only like 24 counties that don't have that capability. Yeah. So, I mean, that's good stuff.
Yeah. So, you know, when they say, near full deployment expected this year, that's not an unrealistic number to look for, I don't think. 911 statewide answered 9 million calls for help.
Wow. Yeah.
That's blow away.
Yeah. We've just released our numbers in Chester.
Yeah.
We're just over 400,000.
Wow. Wow. Very cool.
Yeah.
$324 million worth of grants were administered in 2019. A neat little, what I think, mitigation fact is that 159 homes were acquired or elevated, with 99 more expected this year. And again, this is talking about, when you look at these flood-prone communities, you got to build up. You got to kind of elevate homes and do that kind of a thing. So that was a fun fact. And this one also was, I didn't know this one, that in Harrisburg City, they were the first sinkhole mitigation project using FEMA's pre-disaster mitigation grant funds in the country in 2019. I didn't know that one either. Did you know there were 35 tornadoes in 2019 across the Commonwealth?
I knew the number was high because you and I had talked about it.
Right. And that was the most in 1 year since 1998.
Wow.
Pretty fascinating. The Commonwealth Response Coordination Center at PEMA headquarters was activated 26 times in 2019.
Wow.
So, just about a little north of two per month on average, 277 emergency management courses offered, and what I think is a fantastic number, there were 310 emergency management coordinators certified in 2019. So that would be all the basic, the advanced, the professional things. So again, fun Pima facts. All this information is available on their website. I just love to pillage their website and use these as discussion points. But are you ready for today's main discussion point?
I'm ready.
Because I think this is going to tie into what you were talking about with your JICJIS thing that you went to in Tennessee. And so there was a recent study on Twitter usage during disasters. I don't know if you saw it. I don't know if you read it. But this was by the University of Vermont. And this was a study that was done between 2011 and 2016 and included hurricanes such as Sandy, Irene, the Midwest tornado outbreaks, and a whole bunch of Louisiana flooding. So check out one of the key points they made in this report. They said that social media influencers are out-tweeted during disasters by regular people with 100 to 200 followers. So let that just sink in for, So meaning, you know, you think of any celebrity that has a million followers or more, any social media influencer that's popular on YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram that has a million followers. There are a lot of companies that reach out to these social media influencers and pay them to say, hey, tweet a picture of my new product or tweet a picture of my hotel or tweet this information about this upcoming class or whatever, you know, kind of a thing. They rely heavily on social media influencers to get the word out for specific things. However, in the world of disaster, that doesn't work. This study proved that regular people on Twitter that are putting out accurate, good information with the right hashtags, those tweets get viewed more, get shared more, get saved more than a social media influencer with 1 million followers. So I thought that was absolutely fantastic. So if you're an emergency manager on Twitter, don't worry about how many followers you have because I used to flip out about this because on my personal one, I don't know, like I've been stuck at 4,400 Twitter followers on my personal one, but when I created our OEM Twitter account 2 years ago, like we can't get it beyond 200 to save our life. And that used to bum me out. But I'm going to make the point about that here in a minute, why I'm no longer worried about that. But this report further goes on to say that accurate information at the right time to a small network from a reputable source will get out faster than an influencer with a million followers. Here's the cool part of this report that my eyes went right to. The top keywords used on Twitter before and after disasters. You're going to love this, Amy, because this is right up your alley. Before a hurricane strikes, the top keywords that are used on Twitter are groceries, supermarket, and prepare.
Those are like my three favorite words.
No, I get it. But that's what this study showed. These people that did this report at the University of Vermont, this is all they've been doing is putting this data together. Here's another one. After a tornado strikes, the top keywords used are shelter, emergency, wind, and food security. Yeah, I'm telling you, this is the report. You just got to read the report.
I would have thought that the top words would have been like, I'm safe, we're safe, okay, you know, like, yeah. like keywords like that.
Well, this is citizen journalism now, you know, these are the words people are putting out there.
So does Twitter, like, can Twitter go through and, like, see what the big words are, like, before and after? Because, like, Facebook algorithms will tell you, like during Hurricane Sandy, you know, the top words after were, like, we're safe, I'm safe, we're okay, I'm okay. Like, does Twitter have that capability, too?
Yeah, by searching the hash word, by searching the hashtags.
By hashtag.
Yeah.
Okay.
So that's that. So, again, yeah, I love this kind of data. I think it's fantastic, but the takeaway from this to everyone in the emergency management world, because you and I have both met with people and talked with a lot of people around the state about this at the conference. Stop ignoring Twitter and stop being afraid of it. It doesn't matter if you have 10 followers. You have the same open road as someone that has a million followers on Twitter. You just have to put your message together, learn a little bit about that platform, the formatting, how to use it, and you can get accurate, reputable messages out to whoever you need to get them out to. We talk often about creating meaningful networks on social media. A great place to start on Twitter is following my emergency management list on Twitter. I have over 400 people from around the world that are specific emergency management people. You can go to my profile on Twitter, click lists, click the subscribe button, and you can have that feed of all of those people too. You can add to it, you can build your own, but you've got to have a decent, reputable social media network. The other tip moving forward with this is to engage your local media. Follow them so they follow you. And, you know, when we and when I said I used to worry about our followers on our OEM Twitter page, one of the first things I did when that had zero followers was I'm friends with a lot of the local media journalists and reporters and photographers and videographers here in Western Pennsylvania. I sent each of them direct messages from the OEM Twitter account and said, hey, this is the official emergency management Twitter account for the borough of White Oak. You know, please follow it in case you ever need info on something we may be tweeting about. And so that's who our, you know, less than 200 followers are, is they're all media people. They're all important people. They're all people that are going to look at us as a reputable source and get the message out there and retweet the message and share it. But it all begins with you having to be proactive enough to send them a direct message on Twitter and just say, hey, follow me.
And if you don't, if you're in between media markets, in between different areas, or don't have that strong of a media presence, you know, in your area, reaching out to your local newspaper, reaching out to those citizen journalism blogs, you know, becoming friendly with them also will help you, will help you get your word out and you be the source of information in your community.
Absolutely. Yep. Couldn't agree more. And again, this is all, you know, one of the many benefits of the KEMA conference. You know, we did things last year like the social media happy hour, where we were able to disseminate some great information, a little document with a lot of tips and tricks for things on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, YouTube, Nextdoor, you know, all those types of social media platforms. But it's also about building those networks, sharing those tips, and all realizing we're all in this thing together.
Do we want to do the social media happy hour again at the conference?
I think we should.
Yeah. I mean, think of all of that, all those people that we had there together for a couple hours. I mean, granted, there was also a good game, a football game one too, I think, but.
Yep. So, Amy, that's it for episode 41. Thank you for joining me.
Thanks for having me.
And that's going to do it for episode 41 of the KEMA Podcast.